Hi, I'm Bill Gaither, and I am so thrilled to introduce you to my dear friends, Joey and Rory. I am turning to the light. You know, this award-winning country duo has brought beautiful music to television audiences and live concert venues all across North America. And today, these rising stars celebrate their roots with some great, good old gospel songs and some wonderful new songs about the important things in life. Being beside you when we grow old. Plus, we are going to get to know these kids a whole lot better. So stick around. Gaither Music Group is pleased to present Joey and Rory, Inspired.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Like a seedling in the clay, when the sun's first golden ray marks the breaking of the day, I am turning to the light. I am reaching toward the sun. I have journeyed through the night, and the battle now is won. There's a new song in my heart. There's a new day dawning bright. Oh, I'm turning to the light. Not so very snow, with no sign of spring in sight. Now I'm turning to the light. I am turning to the light. I am reaching toward the sun. I have journeyed through the night, and the battle now is won. There's a new song in my heart. There's a new day dawning. Listening, I will raise my voice and sing. I am turning to the light. I am turning to the light. I am reaching toward the sun. I have journeyed through the night, and the battle now is won. There's a new song in my heart. There's a new day dawning. Sun. I have journeyed through the night, and the battle now is won. There's a new song in my heart. There's a new day dawning bright. Oh, I'm turning to the light. Oh, I'm turning to the light. Joey
and Rory, that was that looked like a lot of fun. In a barn, right?
In a barn. You can have a lot of fun in a barn.
Well, I know Joey and her family, you grew up on a farm, and so barn was very friendly.
Very appropriate. I felt right at home. Growing up here in Alexandria, Indiana.
Well, this whole project is a combination of of real life, which includes the country if you're from Alexandria, Indiana. And we are, by the way, we are in her hometown. In fact, I had her mother and her dad both in English class when I taught way back in the Stone Age, I think. That was a long, long time ago.
Yes, it was.
They were great kids, and they produced a wonderful family. So I'm very, very familiar with the Martin family. How many? You had a sister?
Three sisters and a brother.
Yes.
Yes, I'm the middle of five. Yeah. And it was so neat growing up here. And what was neat about it, though, is as a kid, growing up here, and what you probably don't realize is we knew you were somebody. We just didn't know, like, how big of a somebody you were. But I remember we'd come into the grocery store at 5:30 in the morning to come get our groceries to go work in the fields, and you would be in the grocery store picking out your blueberries and your yogurt at 5:30 in the morning. We'd say, "Mom, there he is. There's that Mr. Gaither." She said, "Now don't bother him."
Well, you need to tell Gloria that, because I'm trying to convince her I am a legend, but she hasn't bought into it. She hasn't bought into
it. I'll talk to her.
And then, Roy, you came along somewhere later on. My son was the first one who said, "Dad, you've got to know this kid," said, "he's writing some great, great songs, and they are magic together," he said.
Mm. Well, Benji did. He kind of introduced us. He was working on a project, and he kind of brought us in on it. It took a little while for it to all come to be, but once it did, you know, when the right thing comes along, you know it, and everybody else knows it. And I always believed that my wife was a special singer, and that the world was going to discover her someday, but I had no idea what a good seat I was going to have to watch it happen. So,
not only is she a special singer, she's a very special person. Mm-hmm. And in this field, people are pretty sharp, and they find out what is behind that great, great, wonderful voice, and there's a wonderful human being. But there are two wonderful human beings, and today we're going to explore that and have a whole lot of fun in doing it. Where did this song come from, A Long Line of Love? Did you write it?
No, I didn't write it. That's a Paul Overstreet song. Paul Overstreet and Tom
Skyler. I know Paul Overstreet, yeah.
I know. You've told us some stories. He was around. You were a big part of his early career, I think, right?
Well, he's not here to defend himself. But when they came to town, there were a couple of us who'd been there for a while who... you know, many times when artists come to town, writers come to town, they need money to get started.
Yeah.
So we formed an early publishing company, not knowing how big they were going to get. They finally got too big for our little company, but we were there for the first little company that they had, and it was good to get to know Paul and his journey of faith also. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, he was a big inspiration to me when I was a younger man. He was just one of those rare guys in country music that really sang about his faith and his family, and he really didn't sing about much else than that. But he did it in a way like that didn't make me run away from it. It drew me to it. I felt like I could understand it, and I could aspire to live like that. And this song tells the story of just this man, and he comes from this long line of love. You know, they stay together. That's what they do. And so we're going to get through this, and then when he has kids, he tells his son the same thing. It's going to work out. We stay together. We come from a long line of love. Well, I didn't really come from a long line of love. You know, I'm like a lot of people out there. My history, my generations before me, it got a little tangled. That line got broken many, many times.
Relationships are tough. Don't let anybody kid you. They're just very tough.
They are tough. Yeah. And that's one of my favorite things about songs is that those characters in those songs are who you draw inspiration from. Yeah. And if you don't have a grandfather that stayed forever with his wife and your father and mother, then you look at those people and you say, I want to be like them. And so this was one of those songs. It's not really a gospel song, but it's preaching the gospel to me.
Sure. I love it.
I bought a beautiful diamond ring, offered it to the sweetest thing I know, and she said she would take it. We started making some wedding plans. She looked at me and she took my hand and said, do you think we can make it? I said, my granddad's still in love with my grandma. I said, my dad still thinks my mom's the sweetest thing he ever saw. I come from a long line of love when times get hard. We don't give up. Forever's in my heart and in my blood. You see, I come from a long line of love. Years went by and we had a son. Now he thinks that he's found the one for him. And they're planning a wedding. He called me up on the phone today just to see what I had to say to him. Did I think he was ready? I said what his grandfather used to say to me. It's been handed down for ages. It runs in the family. You come from a long line of love. When times get hard, you won't give up. Forever's in your heart and in your blood. Son, you come from a long line of love. Yes, you come from a long line of love.
Rory, I guess there's a lot of curiosity about your bib overhauls. People want to know. Inquiring minds want to know.
Well, it's not that exciting a story. I'm actually from Kansas, and we live on a farm, but that's not really why I wear overalls.
Yeah.
I think it became one less thing. You know, years ago, probably before I met Joey, 12 or 15 years ago, I started wearing overalls. I'd wear them a day or two here and there, and they were so comfortable that I'd start wearing them a little bit more and a little bit more. And pretty soon, that was the only thing that I would wear. And so for years and years, I don't wear anything. I don't have anything else. I just wear overalls all the time. And I think part of it is that I was in the Marines for 8 years. Mm. When I was young, I joined the Marine Corps, and I served from 82 to 90. And so I liked having a uniform on. So in a lot of ways, as silly as it might seem, overalls feels like a uniform. I just put it on every day, and she tells me what shirt to wear. And the other thing is it turned out, I thought that it would be a bad thing, but people sure recognize us quick.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the
soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Soul-cleansing
blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed? and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed?
Are you washed in the blood?
In the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
That's good stuff. Now, you know that you're with an old historian here, don't you? I mean, when you talk about old songs, I may not be the best, but I'm awfully good at remembering. A guy, a pastor from Philadelphia named Brother Tinley wrote this song. He also wrote, "By and By, When the Morning Comes." Remember that old song?
I usually do this for those. Do you remember that song, Danny?
I'm not a historian.
You're not a historian?
I'm not. Neither of us are.
But this is a great old song that he wrote. Leave it there. Leave it there. Take your burdens to the Lord. Leave it there. Where did you hear this?
Rory and I were on our honeymoon out in Darby, Montana. And we went to this little church on Sunday morning. And it was so ironic that there was a mother and daughter that got up and sang a song. They actually lived in Nashville, Tennessee. They were singers. They called the Bakers. Mm-hmm. And they sang the song that morning. And it left such an impression on us. Their version, their harmonies. We just loved it. And we remembered how they sang it. And I hate to say it, but we kind of stole what they did.
Yeah. We did more than that.
Okay, well, we're giving them credit, though.
No, their version was incredible, but that's how we learned it, from these girls singing it that morning. And we came home, and we were trying to find the song. And so we went to a little church in Mount Pleasant down the road from us, and we had visited a couple churches, and we were looking in hymnals trying to find one, and we finally found it in the hymnal. And it had all the words. And so we didn't just steal the song. We might have took that hymnal home.
Well, we were going to give it back.
We're still going to.
I know exactly where it is, and we're going to return that.
I don't know if you can use that, but that's where we got that song.
That may be another trip to the altar for you.
Oh, no.
What a forgiveness, right?
Right. Leave it there, honey. Put the hymnal back. Leave it there.
It sure speaks to us, doesn't it?
It does. In fact, it was so funny. We were singing around the kitchen table one morning, and we had raised a bunch of little chicks. And we had this one that had some feet that were kind of going crookedy. And Rory and I were literally putting little braces on it. And we were singing the song.
She was putting a splint on a baby chicken that had a leg that was crooked.
And we were singing this line. It said, "How he feeds the little bird." And because we had to hand feed this little bird. And we were singing it that morning. And we just literally realized what we were singing, and we were holding this little tiny baby bird and trying to, you know, get it to be better. And it was just such a neat parallel. And
it really was.
Yeah, so sweet.
The bird didn't make it, though.
No.
But it was a sweet story.
It was a sweet story.
If the world from you withholds of its silver and its gold, and you have to get along with meager fare, just remember in his word how he feeds the little bird. Take your burden to the Lord, leave it there, leave it there. Trust him through your doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord, leave it there.
Beautiful.
If your body suffers pain and your health you can't regain, and your soul is slowly sinking in despair, Jesus knows the pain you feel. He can save and he can heal. Take your burden to the Lord. Leave it there, leave it there. Just take your burden to the Lord, oh, and leave it there. If you trust him through your doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord. Your burden to the Lord. Leave it there.
Two delightful kids have written some beautiful and meaningful songs, but to be honest with you, they've also written some crazy songs. It was a lot of fun hearing them cut loose on some of their more lighthearted material. Laura and I often tell young songwriters, write what you know. And these kids have done that very well. Apparently, they know some pretty funny, interesting characters.
Because Granny's got her Daisy Dukes on.
You know, it's easy for artists to take ourselves way too seriously. So it was refreshing to see that Joey and Rory have learned to embrace who they are and who they're not.
Songwriting genius.
You know, I was with the Oak Ridge boys one night, and they said, we got a new song. I said, where did you get it from? They said, a guy by the name of Rory. I said, I said, and it was the coolest song about this guy who was trying to be hip. Because he could remember, and they did it. Remember, they did a video on
yeah,
it.
Yeah, they did.
And when he was young, he was cool and he was hip.
Yeah. Let me do a little bit of that. Sitting at a red light, down around sunset. Girl pulled up beside me in a candy apple red Corvette. She pulled down her shades and gave me a wink. Gave her a little smile back. Then she laughed as she hit the gas, and I remember where I was at. It's hard to be cool when you're behind the wheel of a eight passenger automobile and a big bubble cruising down the street with Barney Blair and a baby seat. Hey, it can be done, but I'm telling you, man, it's hard to be cool in a minivan.
But it can be done.
Hot working on anything recently?
Well, we have been doing some writing recently. We've been working on a new record, and with that, we've been doing some new songs. Do you want to hear a piece of one?
Yeah, yeah.
Would that be okay?
Yeah.
What you gonna do?
You're gonna do it.
If it's new, I won't know it. If tomorrow I woke up and this dream wasn't here, and if I walked out on the stage and no one began to cheer, if the spotlight that I'm in should fade then disappear into the blue, and if our new songs on the charts all began to fall and there is no more acclaim or gold records on the wall, and if no one wants to come and hear us sing at all, I'll sing for you.
There That's good.
I'll sing for you in the kitchen while you strum your old guitar. Like we did when times were tough and luck was hard. Oh, we never ever dreamed we'd get this far.
So
here
good.
We are sitting with Bill Gaither.
That is so good. That is so good.
I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tell. None other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet. The birds hush, they're singing, and the is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tell. None other has ever known, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
The great thing about country music is it's still a music that can tell a story.
That's right.
And not so much of the pop stuff does that anymore, but if you want to hear a good story song, you still have to go to the country, right?
That's right. That's right. You sure do.
And this one is about a car, and probably wasn't much of a car, right?
Wasn't much of a car. This is another song that we found. I'm an old car guy. I love old cars. When I moved to Nashville in 1995, no one knew who I was, but I moved there in a 1956 Chevy. So they knew I was there, even if they didn't know who I was.
It was your daily driver.
That was my daily driver.
Your only driver.
I still have that car, and I've always loved
it. You still have it?
I still have it, yeah. I've always loved old cars, and one time when we were here, we got to jump in. It's like a big Cadillac, big convertible that you have. What is that? Yeah.
Chevrolet Impala 1972.
Yes. Pretty nice.
Convertible.
Yeah.
We got to ride around with you in that one day. I still have it,
yeah.
Real low mileage, if I remember.
31,000 miles. I'm the original owner.
Oh, you are?
Goodness. Yeah.
Wow, we should. It's pretty day today. We should take that off.
We'll do that.
Got time to kill for the cookout.
So this song's really about a father giving his son the old car. and some wisdom to go along with that old car.
The night before I turned 16, I knew better than to dream of waking up to shiny chrome and steel. 'Cause Dad had made it clear that we weren't like the neighbors down the street who bought their son a brand new set of wheels. When morning came, I was shocked, looked out in the drive and saw a red ribbon wrapped round Daddy's old blue Ford. Well, I thought, he must be kidding me. But when he handed me the keys, he proudly smiled and said, son, she's all yours. It'll get you where you're going. It'll take you where you need to be. You know, down through the years, son, it's been faithful to me. I know it don't look like much. It's old and a little beat up. But there's peace of mind in knowing. It'll get you where you're going. Like young men do, took one last glance at my old room. Tears filled Mama's eyes the day I left. Dad didn't have a dime to spare, but he showed me how much he cared when he handed me his Bible and he said, it'll get you where you're going. It'll take you where you need to be. You know, down through the years, son, it's been faithful to me. I know it don't look like much. It's old and a little beat up, but there's peace of mind in knowing it'll get you where you're going. Oh, where you need to be. You know, down through the years, son, it's been faithful to me. I know it don't look like much. It's old and a little beat up. But there's peace of mind in knowing it'll get you where you're going. I know it don't look like much. It's old and a little beat up. But there's peace of mind in knowing it'll get you where you're going.
I'm just thinking about something. This looks very good, I mean, to me. It just looks like two kids who really love each other. You ever fight?
Very rarely do we ever get into any kind of argument. We just really admire one another. We respect one another. We love one another. But most of all, we know that God had a plan for us to be together. And that's, we can't give anybody else credit but Him for putting us together.
And that's easily something that people say. But for us, we really did. When we met, Joey told me, you know, she had seen me play at a songwriter's night, and she told me, I knew at that moment that you were the person I'm supposed to spend the rest of my life with. And then I prayed.
Now where was that?
That, the first time I ever saw him perform was at the Bluebird Cafe there in Nashville.
Yeah, with a lot of writers.
A lot of writers, and I was just new to Nashville, and I didn't know the songwriting community. I didn't know anything about it. I just was so naive. Coming from Alexandria. But I just loved the way that he wrote, the way that he talked, the way that he walked, just his presence. And he just had a real kindness to him. And I didn't even meet him that night. And I just, sitting, watching him perform, I said to myself, I don't know who that man is, but I'm going to marry him someday. And it wasn't until a couple songs later that he introduced his daughters to the crowd. And so I just assumed he was married, and I just went on about my life in Nashville and working. 2 years pass, and I heard that he was playing another songwriter's night. And when I found out that he was, I said, I've got to go. I just have to see if all those feelings I had are still there. And by that time, I learned that he was a single dad, that he had raised his daughters by himself from the time they were tiny little babies. And that just made me love him even more. And then after that night, it was over for me. I was like, oh, my goodness.
Very first conversation I had with her, she told me about that she had seen me play at the Bluebird 2 years before that. And she said, I knew at that moment, we're going to spend the rest of our lives together. And it, believe it or not, it took me a little while to catch up to her. And so I prayed, like, God, am I really supposed to be with this girl? And it was, God had been really working on my character and my life for a couple of years. And when she came into my life, into our lives, the girls and I prayed, okay, God, if I'm really supposed to be with her, I need a sign from you. And you, I think you'll appreciate this story. So I said, I need a real sign. Now, I probably shouldn't have asked for that, but I felt like it was so unusual for a woman this beautiful to come to a guy like me and go, you're who I'm going to spend the rest of my life with. Usually I'm chasing a woman this beautiful and she's running from me. So I said, God, am I really supposed to be with this woman? I need a sign. So I played again at the Bluebird Cafe and Joey went with me. She was there and her mother was there. And Joey got up and sang a song that we wrote together. And then we went back to her little apartment and I was asking her, I said, where did you, you know, where did you learn to play music? And she said, well, my dad played guitar growing up.
Yeah.
And I said, my dad played guitar growing up. And I said, well, what kind of songs did they play? And she said, well, my mom and dad sang songs. I don't know who sang them. They were just songs that they sang around the house. I don't know who did them on the radio. I said, my dad did songs that I didn't know who sang them. They were just songs my dad did. I said, like what? And she picked up the guitar.
Get your guitar there.
And she sang this.
Have I told you lately that I love you?
Which is an old Jim Reeves song.
I know it. Keep going. Keep going. This is too good.
Let me tell you once again, somehow. Have I told you lately that I love you? Well, darling, I'm telling you now.
Oh, Gloria, where are you?
But what's amazing about that is she didn't just sing a pretty song. When I was a boy growing up, my dad wanted to move to Nashville and be a singer, and he knew about 10 songs, and he lived in Kansas, and he worked for the railroad, so it never happened. And he passed away in 1988, and my dad's favorite song of all time was Have I Told You Lately That I Love You? So.
And when his father passed away, they sang one song at his funeral. And it was, Have I Told You Lately That I Love You? And I think it was kind of at that moment where Rory said, okay, God, I don't need any more signs. This is where I'm supposed to go, and I won't question you. And
I married the supermodel.
we started dating, and for 2 months, we made a trip back here for my folks to meet Rory.
In Alexandria, Indiana.
Mm-hmm. We came here and...
Brought the girls with us.
And that night, we went and talked to my mama. We went and talked to my daddy. And then we walked to the cross where my brother had his accident.
On the side of the road. There's a white cross there.
And Rory proposed to me that night, 2 months after we started dating. And 2 months later, we were married. And that was 11 years ago.
And for us, even though I had been a single father for all those years, and by then the kids were 13 and 15, we both really wanted God's blessing upon our life and our relationship. And it felt like that God was involved in this. You know, I write songs about magic. It doesn't really happen. But in this one, like God was writing a song, and I was a part of it. We were part of it. And so when we got married, we committed to wait until we got married. And by then I was, how old was I, 37?
36.
You were 36 and you were 26. And that's an important part of it, to make that decision. And we believed that if we just tried really hard to honor him, he would hopefully honor our marriage. And now we've been married for 11 years. And for us to go on and have a wonderful marriage and to be happy 5 years later, and to think that's as good as it can get. I mean, just to have a great marriage. Most people don't get that. And then him to turn a corner, us to walk around a corner, and him to have a career together waiting for us after that. Yes, we sing songs. And yes, we get to travel around, but that's not the story. The story is how we got here. And it's what makes it so powerful, because we're in awe of the whole thing. So, you know, we're sitting here with Bill Gaither telling our story. How does that happen?
I love your song. That's important to me because it's about everyday stuff. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know, that song came about, Rory and I had just gotten married, and we went in town to write with his buddy, Tim Johnson. And I'm not a writer. I didn't move down to be a writer. I don't have the gift that y'all have in that. Everybody has an idea or thoughts and concepts. But we sat down and we started making a list, because they said, we're going to write a song for Joey.
Things that are important.
Things that are important to me. And so I started writing a list of what the things that my parents instilled in me as a girl. You know, you're not going to watch TV all day. You're going to pay your bills. You're going to go outside, enjoy the fresh air. And that list literally became the song that is really now kind of the cornerstone
of our music.
Of our music and of our marriage and our life together.
Not planning our day around the TV set, paying our bills and staying out of debt. That's important to me. That's important to me. Opening the windows and letting in air, holding hands when we're saying a prayer. That's important to me. Yeah, that's important to me. Having somebody to share my life, loving my husband and being a wife, and the very best mother I can be. That's important to me. Somewhere, still being ourselves if we ever get there. That's important to me. That's important to me. Yeah, that's important to me. That's important to me.
It's been just a joy to get to know you better. You're the real deal. And I know you've guessed a couple times on our videos, the vocal band, and some of the other videos. But to get to know you better and have our folks get to know your heart, who you're all about, very good. And you have to know that we are so proud of you. So proud of you.
Thank you. We feel very honored, and we've been looking forward to this time and allowing us to be able to do an inspirational album, something I've been wanting to do for a very, very long time. So thank you for that and for believing in us as much as you have and supporting us.
You and your wife have been a big inspiration for us, and we really appreciate that.
She loves you.
Okay.
We love you.
Thank you. We love you too.
Thank you.
Good day.
Take us somewhere, still being ourselves if we ever get there. That's important to me. That's important to me. Yeah, that's important to me. That's important to me.